Greetings. My name is Guy Dauncey, and this is the show Change the World, where we explore big, bold ideas for really inventing a way better future. And because we have a provincial election coming up in May, as some of you have hopefully noticed, I put the invitation out to a number, to all the candidates locally, to say, do you want to come on the show and talk about who you are, why you're running, and what the game is? So today, I'm really happy to have Leonard Krog, who's been the MLA for Nanaimo for the last 12 years and for a chunk of time previous to that. Born in Nanaimo, raised in Coombs, island boy, probably went to school. No, you must know gazillions of people locally. A practicing lawyer, so you've been in business. First elected in 1991. Opposition critic for the Attorney General. You must have filled every role under the sun during those years. But also, I should add, past director and president of the Mid-Island Consumer Services Cooperative and past chair of United Way for Nanaimo and a host of... Anyway, welcome to the show. Why do you want to run for, let me see, your fourth or would it be fifth term?
Actually, it will be my fourth. Why do I want to run? I think anyone who goes into public life, notwithstanding what people say about politicians, wants to leave some kind of a legacy, wants to make a difference. I come from a family where my granny joined the British Labour Party not long after Keir Hardie founded it. She heard the old man speak in Newcastle. And so a social conscience and the belief in the struggle for social justice and economic justice has always been part of who I was. I got into politics a little earlier than I'd anticipated because there was an opportunity to run in Nanaimo initially. I lost that nomination. Jan Pullinger won, and then I got the nomination in Parksville-Qualicum for the 91 election. Yeah. So,
91 feels like decades ago.
It was a long time ago, and we could talk about some of the things we were talking about in that campaign, which are still true today, unfortunately.
We need to talk about the present and the future.
Yes. Why am I running again? Yeah. Because I want to be part of a government that is actually going to make some changes in British Columbia.
Yeah.
You know, the old coalition, and it is the same old coalition that's governed this province with some exceptions since the dark days of the Liberal Conservative coalition. Those changes are necessary.
So let me put a personal question. Say the NDP got elected, either to stand alone or in coalition with the Greens, which wouldn't be very difficult, frankly. Are there two or three really big themes you've been sitting on that you can say, now we can make this happen?
Well, for me personally, For me personally, I think the issues around poverty have been a driver.
Right.
I grew up in a small community. I didn't grow up poor. Relatively comfortable circumstances, even though my mom was widowed when I wasn't quite five.
Yeah.
And the face of poverty, which I see downtown in my office every day, reminds me of the incredible disparities in our community and in our province.
Right.
And the Liberals' singular failure and indeed deliberate actions that have kept people poor, whether it's refusing to raise the minimum wage, refusal to raise assistance rates to something remotely resembling the poverty level, that drives me. The other things I think that are up there is around the concept of government and its importance and its value. You know, we're campaigning this time very strongly on banning corporate union donations, which you've done before, limiting campaign contributions, getting money out of politics.
Yeah.
Because look, civilized societies are governed by good governments.
Yeah.
And good government is important. I mean, as T.C. Douglas said, you know, we try to do through government collectively what we can't do individually.
So let me put that one to one side and come back to the poverty issue. As well as the obvious things like raising the minimum wage to $15 and paying more people on disability, are there any sort of more solid structural approaches that you would really, you know, let's assume that you had 8 years in government and got, you know, a second term, some big changes that would make a difference to that? I mean, the way I see it, we're the only province without an anti-poverty strategy.
Yes.
A third of the people don't own properties are getting left behind. It's just not an acceptable way to do things.
No.
So what's the big thinking?
And you've hit on one of them, which we have committed to before. And when I say we, I don't mean the royal we like Queen Victoria. I mean the Democratic Party, the opposition.
Yes.
It is an anti-poverty strategy. Every province in Canada, including Newfoundland, for heaven's sakes, has one. And it does have impacts. Common Ground had a wonderful article, I think in the last issue, I quoted in the legislature. In Canada, 46% of the wealth, if I followed, if I remember correctly, is held by the top 10% across the country. In British Columbia, I think the figure for the top 10% is 56%. In other words, the disparities are greater in British Columbia than the national average. The bottom 10% in Canada, I think it's 5.6% of the national wealth they control or have, and in British Columbia, it's only 3.1.
Yeah.
So the disparities are obvious, and I would like to think that most British Columbians are hearing that and understanding it. They're seeing it in their daily lives, lack of increases in income.
Yeah.
In terms of how you remedy that, it isn't just about an anti-poverty strategy. It's about driving the creation of employment that is both satisfying and obviously, and this is a bit of a suck up to you, in terms of that employment that is good for the environment and good for the planet.
Yeah.
We have every opportunity here. We're arguing about building pipelines, for heaven's sakes, when China is moving rapidly to wind power, when the Danes are way ahead of us,
so
when I have people in this community who are strong advocates of, understand, and are ready to work on tidal and wave power.
Yeah.
I mean, I'd like to think at the end of 8 years where we'd be is one of the most forward-looking and progressive governments in the country, and indeed in the Western world, where people would say, look, these folks are way ahead of us, and by the way, they're generating incredible employment at the same time and lifting people out of poverty. Does it get better than that?
Yeah, and tied to the poverty issue is, and the fact that the lowest 10% have only got 3% of the property of wealth, most of that wealth is expressed in property, and right now the housing crisis, it's big. How far do you think the Liberal strategy goes to tackle the housing crisis?
It doesn't go very far at all, and indeed you could argue that the 15% foreign buyers tax implemented in only one part of the province is not doing anything to bring down house prices. Indeed, what it has done is help drive up the cost of housing in Victoria. And look, if you own a house, these are good times.
Yeah.
It's helping drive up the price of housing. And now, if you own a house again, it's good times.
That means the gap is widening all the time.
Exactly. And so...
So top two strategies for the NDP, if you're in office, for tackling the housing crisis.
The housing crisis, firstly, my personal view is you bring in a foreign buyer's tax that applies across the province instead of singling out communities.
Okay.
In terms of development, you provide incentives, if necessary and appropriate, to encourage more multifamily dwellings, particularly in concentrated urban areas. I mean, the strategy in Nanaimo, let's talk local, is to get 5,000 more people living downtown, and so we should.
Yeah.
They won't be driving their cars to buy their goods, they won't be driving their cars to get to work, all of those things. But that requires cooperation with municipal government as well, but it is the goal. And I think those things are possible.
And cooperative housing?
Would cooperative that housing, absolutely. I mean, look, we're shifting to a different time. I mean, some people are doing it already automatically. There's nothing that has happened in Europe that can't happen here. And we're always looking to reinvent the wheel. Some of the models around housing, some people don't expect to pay off mortgages. Maybe that's a good thing, maybe that's a bad thing. In a country with so much wealth and so much land, though, the concept, and I understand it, Sharon and I live in a single-family dwelling on a city lot, I understand that. But the concept that everyone is going to have that may not be necessarily possible, but the concept that someone will have an ownership of a piece of real estate in this way we think of it, a condominium, a cooperative housing, some unit, something that gives them a sense of well-being and security.
Have you come across the concept of having community land trusts, so land is taken off the market forever, but you can own your house in the land trust and your children can inherit it, but you're not riding that property conveyor belt?
Good idea. Don't disagree with it.
Yeah.
Supportive of it.
Yeah.
But it's very hard, I think, to move people to these concepts when we're so close to a generation that enjoyed the benefits of the post-war boom.
For those who have property, it makes no sense at all.
Exactly. It's an odd question of sense.
If you have no hope of earning property at all, it's that or renting endlessly.
But to move their children and their grandchildren to that concept, it does take time. Now, in major centers, you're seeing some of this work out in solutions that people are engaging in themselves.
Yeah.
Two people not cohabiting decide they'll buy a two-bedroom condominium together.
Yeah.
I mean, people find practical solutions when they're confronted with a problem. I mean, that's the one, we are an inventive species.
But one of, when I was driving down through Duncan the other day, and there's a new tent city on the corner of the Aboriginal land by the bridge, very prominent. So, here, that's a solution, but only a valid solution in terms of being in our face and saying, please do something.
Yeah, well, exactly. It's a solution. You know, what is it? The French philosopher who said something to the effect, the law in its majestic equality forbids the rich as well as the poor to beg in the streets, to steal bread, and to sleep under bridges.
Yeah.
That's not a solution, but what that does reflect is, come back to my earlier point around the incredible disparities that we're seeing in our community, in our province, and in our country, indeed in many parts of the Western world, where governments are failing to address their fundamental responsibility, which is to ensure the well-being and safety of their citizens.
Yeah, the Green Party's talking about doing a pilot study for a basic income program, where every citizen would get a guaranteed monthly, or as I would put it, yearly flow of income. Has the NDP got any position on that?
I won't call that a radical solution, because I know it's being tried. And in I believe it's Finland is taking
Finland's
a step.
Finland's doing a study. Holland exactly. is, Scotland is. Yeah. They're all doing studies.
I mean, those are big concepts.
Yes.
And but if they're
That's
seen,
what this show's about.
If they're seen exactly, but if they're seen to work, then it's easy to move people. But you have to prove that it works first. I mean, it's what's the motto of Missouri? Show me.
One of my concerns with basic income is if everyone's getting a monthly, whatever it's 500 or 1,000, that it might take the pressure off the need to increase wages, because the employer said, well, you got that. And so, but if it was an annual piece, people could then get a more of a lump sum of capital they could use to do something, and it wouldn't have the same wage impact.
It's possible.
They could backfire if people say there's no need to increase wages because you're all getting a basic income.
The pace of change is, and I've lived long enough to see it, is increasing, and quite rapidly.
Yeah.
You know, whole industries, the video industry literally came and went, was worth billions of dollars, employed tens of thousands of Canadians, and it's utterly and completely gone, essentially, now.
Yeah.
And we're seeing those kinds of changes. Will that come in the next 5 or 10 years? I don't know.
Yeah.
People have to be opened up to it. But people certainly, and I think the growth of populism, as that term is used widely and broadly now, the growth of populism is directly attributable to those growing disparities. And so does that make society, individuals, people, unions, corporations, civic leaders more amenable to undertaking more dramatic solutions?
I think it has to. It has to. Quick, total change of emphasis. I'm on a climate crisis. How serious do you think the climate crisis is?
Well, I'm certainly not Donald Trump, I can assure you.
Well, no, he thinks it's a conspiracy invented by the Chinese that doesn't matter a damn, right?
My personal view is that climate change is the most important issue facing humanity, bar none.
And we're on the same page.
Because it impacts on everything. The example I've used for years in elections when I'm speaking to people about this issue, I say, do you not think if there's a hurricane in Florida that loses millions of dollars or billions of dollars of insurance money, that doesn't have an impact on your house insurance in Nanaimo? Yeah. That's just the indirect example. The shift of species,
Okay, so then, solutions. What would the NDP do to accelerate? We've got to move to clean energy, we've got to store more carbon in organic farms, and we've got to store more carbon in sustainably managed forests, and we've got to eat less meat.
All of those things.
Yeah.
But tick. But
some of them are difficult for a government.
Well, exactly.
Other things like sustainable energy and transportation
of them
and buildings.
Some of them are difficult, but of course, with the imaginative use of taxation and regulation, you can encourage the production or consumption of some things and discourage the production and consumption of other things.
Holland, a third of Holland is already under sea level, right? They are discussing legislation that after 2025, that's within 8 years, you would not be allowed to buy any vehicle except an electric one. And they got motivation. And to me, I look at that and I think, well, if 10 other countries did the same thing, you're just accelerating the transition. And the new Tesla is going to have a range of 500 miles, for goodness sake. Like, how do you see progress around electric vehicles and buses ferries? And
that's incredibly positive. But in fairness, I would go a step beyond and the whole concept of private ownership of a vehicle, because this, we're not talking about the campaign, now we're talking about big picture ideas.
Yes.
a driverless cab is going to pick you up and me up and Sally and Bob all in the same neighborhood. It will be computerized. It yep. will charge accordingly based on how far yep. it's really going to carry us. But four cabs are not going to go out with a driver to pick us up, sadly. I mean, I think that is coming. Yep. In other words, Uber, everyone thinks Uber is the next stage. And I'm saying don't count on that, particularly with an aging population, yeah. so that grandma will be able to call for a vehicle that will come and pick her up and take her to wherever she has to go.
Today
and
we,
pick
call
her up.
We call that a taxi. Today.
We call it a taxi, exactly. But, you know, we are going to lose significant employment over the longer haul with that. But that's just one example. So, firstly, do you need as many roads?
Yeah.
If you're reducing the number of vehicles that are used. Yeah. Car cooperatives, we know that's happening in town already, yeah. and in urban centers in particular. Our son, when he was living in Vancouver, is a prime example. The young woman he was living with had a vehicle. They barely ever drove it. They yeah. walked everywhere to get things.
So here's the thing. I founded the Victoria Car Share Co-op, so I follow this thing. And in Vancouver, there are five car share cooperatives. One of them, called Car2Go, the little one with the smart cars, has 120,000 members. So it really, what you're talking about is really taking off as a more convenient way to think about transportation.
And it's happened in just a matter of a few years. Totally. And that's my point about yeah. the pace of change. And so I think one of the jobs of politicians, yes, you know what? The school door has to be open tomorrow. There has to be a bed in the hospital yeah. for someone who's been injured. And that's the practical reality of politics. But yes. one of the reasons I enjoy an exchange like this yeah. is because you can get to talk about the bigger things that are coming rapidly, that frankly, it is the job of politicians and civic leaders to be thinking about, preparing for, and talking about, yeah. and bringing society along. But in the world of modern political discourse, that's a pretty difficult job. I have no idea how many people are going to listen to this tonight. Some may come off and say, that Krog's a futuristic nut bar.
Well, no, if we get the right viral thing, it's all over the place, right? Mm-hmm. Because this is, goes yeah. on YouTube. Yeah. But I would hope that, say, NDP or NDP mm-hmm. Green Coalition happens, mm-hmm. that there's a massive struggle going on within the NDP between those who are saying, no, peace, little bit, and those who are saying, no, big picture vision.
No.
And you want that. It's a healthy struggle. It's healthy.
I think lots of people have a big picture vision, but you have to be able to do it in a way that they believe will not completely disrupt their lives,
absolutely.
Lose them their livelihoods, cost them their homes, yeah. Ruin the world for a generation, so to speak. But part of it is talking about it. Part of it is proposing practical solutions, implementing it. And doing, you know, one of the oldest political things in the world, which is what we talked about with Finland yeah. and other places, do it on an experimental basis yeah. and prove and show that it can work, and it does work.
So is there, coming to forestry, I mean, forestry is part of the climate crisis because we need to suck that surplus carbon out of the atmosphere, and the best ways of doing it through organic farming and sustainable forestry. Is there a way to get the forests on Vancouver Island and BC as a whole to far more sustainable practice, limit the export of raw logs, get more people? I mean, Merv Wilkinson with Wildwood had greater volume of timber and quality of timber by using ecosystem-based methodologies. In fact, his timber, when a tree grows more steadily, you've got tighter fiber. When it just rushes up, it's skimpy and it bends. And it's what are we going to do about forestry?
Well, firstly, I mean, as part of the platform, and it's already been announced, is just the practical aspects. John Horgan, our leader, made an announcement, I think it was in Williams Lake yesterday or the day
yes.
before, just about basic reforestation. And that doesn't mean monoculture either. Those kinds of things are practical, can be done today, employ people, are good for the planet, good for the environment. Over the longer haul, it's also important, I think, to encourage even more use of wood, which you can argue is going the opposite way because you're cutting down trees.
Right.
But it locks the carbon up. But it is also, when you're involved with forestry and using a product that is, in fact, truly sustainable. I mean, from my perspective, where I was raised in Coombs, all of that land, when one set of grandparents came there in 29, the others were there long before, you couldn't see to Qualicum Beach because trees had grown up in the last, roughly, it was about 10, 15 years yeah. since it was cut by old man Ford. And that timber was cut again in, I think, in the 70s, 80s, yeah. I guess. And now it's growing up again.
Yeah.
Now, you can't do that, you know, that's relatively flat land, I get all that. But the reality is that has employed generations of people in the forest industry.
Yeah.
And that's just a simple example. I mean, that's why forestry, I think, is still important. It's not a sunset industry. We face market problems.
But all of us living on the island end up driving behind a logging truck, and we see the size of the logs has gone down to, you know, now they're sort of this sort of size, matchsticks coming out.
Well, I won't use the term matchsticks. I mean, certainly the trees that were cut the second time in the 80s in dear old Coombs weren't the size of the trees that were cut.
That was the 80s, yeah.
Old man Ford told...
I'm wondering, this is way off topic, but all of the privately owned forest land in small acreages, not the big commercial, like the forest I'm living on, I would like to restore that to old growth quality, but doing much more radical thinning and pulling trees out, but to have the know-how to do that, which could also supply the mills.
Also supply the mills, but you know, and I'm going to sound like a hard-headed capitalist here, we have to talk about the marketplace and what's realistic, yeah. and whether the regulations as they exist now and government rules around this are in fact working to promote, sustain, enhance, and expand the industry.
Yeah.
Many will say no. I mean, I can tell you one of the great complaints of my constituents is seeing barges loaded with raw logs moving out of Nanaimo Harbor week after week. On the other hand, the truck loggers are saying, look, this is our livelihood. We employ people. We're the only active part of the forest industry. Then you've got mills like Coastland, for example, saying it's hard for us to get fiber. The same with Harmac.
Yeah.
And you have the Chinese, and I can't be critical of China for becoming an economic powerhouse, but the Chinese prepared to pay much more for a log than British Columbia mills can potentially afford.
From forest to farms, a lot of people... Couch and Valley, all the way up to Courtney, well, Victoria, really keen on growing more food locally. And then we see the farms full of growing hay for horses or subsidized. What could the NDP do to have better support for young farmers?
Well, right off the bat, one commitment that our agriculture critic has made for several years and which we're committed to is I won't say require demanding, but it'll be a little more incentivized than that.
Yeah.
But requiring public institutions to use local food.
Do you know,
I mean, what a remarkable concept, Leonard, that we're not going to fly it from Calgary.
I was at UVic 10 years ago, and the purchaser there had really got involved in local food. And they have a rule at UVic that any purchasing order more than 25,000 must go out to tender. So he looked at the food order, and he broke the whole thing down into orders under 25,000. Did a phenomenal job of getting... So any institution can do that kind of thing if they choose to. Yeah.
They can, if they choose to, but of course it's sometimes easier. And let's be honest, it's a lot harder. And notwithstanding the romantic notion of farming, I'm conscious of the fact that folks moved off the farms because farming is hard work.
It's hard work,
and it's very demanding, and it's
not well paid.
And that's a reality of how we became an urban society. And I've read enough Canadian history to understand that. But there are a number of people who want to do it who don't have the opportunity because of the capital intense nature of it. They don't have the capital to acquire or lease or maintain land. And particularly dairy farm operations, for instance, the cost of quota, those kinds of things, becomes absolutely prohibitive.
And yet we look at it and 95% of our food is coming in on the ferry. So we know that there's something crazy going on in there.
As opposed to the reverse 100 years ago when 95% plus of it was grown here and consumed here.
So let's flip topic again and go back to that. You were talking about open government and the way democracy and government. And first of all, getting the big money out of government. What's the NDP commitment around big money?
Look, we have introduced a bill six times to ban corporate union donations. And what John Horgan has made...
Can you just repeat that for you? Corporate and
union donations.
Okay.
Corporate and union donations. I mean, look, my view is they don't get a vote. Why would you allow them to support political parties?
If I was super rich and won the lottery and wanted to donate 100,000, would that be ruled out as well? Individual?
Absolutely. We're coming to that. Two secs. You ban corporate union donations, you put a cap on individual donations, and you exclude absolutely any out-of-province donations. In other words, no one from outside of British Columbia should be able to influence an election inside British Columbia.
And what do you say to, I think Christy Clark responded, that that means that the public has to finance the elections?
I have never heard so much horse hockey in my life as the Premier suggesting that. That's what she'd like to say. She's trying to convince people, voters, if you do this, the NDP is going to make you pay for political parties. And it's just not true.
Yeah.
What Christy Clark is afraid of is not having a $12 million war chest at the start of the election and raising another $12 million to spend during it. I mean, that's what this is about. My pitch in the ledge when this ridiculously innocuous bill around transparency they brought in, which they let die in the order paper, was brought in, my pitch was simply this. What possible harm can come from banning corporate union donations, capping individual donations, and prohibiting out-of-province donations? There's no harm. There is no harm.
NDP and Greens are really on the same page then around
that. With great respect now, I know you're very partial to Greens.
I'm partial to both. I'm absolutely partial to both. Let me say
that, you know, we've been proposing this for a very long time. I mean, I campaigned for the leadership of my party back in 2003 on this, so did Carol James.
And the Greens, they're doing it as well.
Good for them, but as long as the NDP works within the existing laws and we face a formidable opponent financed by rich people and powerful corporations, we are not going to bring the knife to the gunfight.
So what about future votes for 16-year-olds?
I think its time is coming. I mean, it's not I don't see it as a high priority, interestingly. But certainly we supported a bill that would allow young people who presently aren't able to vote because of age to register early so they would be automatically on the voters list when they came of age. I think that's a very important first step. The federal Liberals, I think very wisely, went after a lot of first-time voters in the last federal election, and that's where they found their victory.
So 3 minutes left, I'm told. Mm-hmm. Let's assume that you do finally get into your frustration factor over the last 12 years must have been fairly immense, just watching everything being done not the way you want it. Right?
Someone wisely said no one cares about the state of the MLA's emotions. However, I would be less than honest if I didn't say, of course, it's frustrating.
Yeah.
We have so much wealth, we have so much opportunity, we have so many people of goodwill, and yet my party is out of power and has remained out of power, and the Liberals have had so many opportunities to make this a better place, to improve the lives of people, and it hasn't. And I think that is driving people. They're conscious of that. They've figured it out. And maybe, just maybe, this time they're prepared to make change.
Yeah.
And you know what? It's not going to be perfect. I've been around. I was in government in 91 to 96 when we made dramatic changes, probably too much change in a short period of time. Same as the Barrett government. Scared people, too much change. But so many of the good things that were done in the early 90s and the good things that were done by Barrett, nobody ever played with after that.
1 minute, straight to camera. The big pitch, you want to say. Choose a camera, go for it.
Look, I hope people get out and vote this election. I think it is the greatest insult to veterans if you think Remembrance Day is important not to vote. The right to vote is sought by hundreds of millions of people around the world who vote in systems that are corrupt. You have that opportunity to choose government. Pay attention. If you vote, it does make a difference. Ask the good citizens of the United States if the fact that they elected George Bush instead of Al Gore doesn't make a difference. Ask the people of the United States if electing Donald Trump, for heaven's sakes, versus Hillary Clinton doesn't make a difference. So I hope they vote. I hope they vote for my party, obviously. And I look forward to that.
I hope you vote.
Yes. And I hope they have the opportunity to serve in government instead of in the opposition for another 4 years.
Well, look, it must be so frustrating not being able to achieve things, but you've done heroic community service in struggling. So, look, thank you for coming on the show.
Very good.
Good luck with the campaigning.
Thank you.
I'm Guy Dauncey. This has been the show Change the World. And do get engaged in the election. Do find out who your candidate is. Do get involved. Whoever you support, get involved and make a difference in the world. Thanks for viewing. Tune in next week for more of the same. Thanks.